a research agronomist. I've been with General Mills for over 20 years. I work on our oat variety selection and supply chain for our company and also support our regenerative agriculture and soil health initiatives at the company. The topic I'm presenting today is on why a food company like General Mills is interested in soil health and regenerative ag, and how we, as a company, we define regenerative ag and those practices and how we're implementing that within our supply chains. So General Mills has been around for 150 years. We rely on agriculture commodities, and we want to make sure that we're in business for another 150 years. And in order to do that, we need to sustain those supply chains. So the farmers that grow commodity oat and wheat for us in the Northern Plains, we need to make sure that they're in business and around for another 150 years as well.
All right, thank you. It's good to be here, and thanks for the invite, and thanks for the warm welcome. It's good to come and see a few familiar faces in the audience, so I appreciate that. A little bit about myself. I grew up on a farm in western Minnesota where I still work with my dad and my cousin and my brother, and we still have some operations there. It's primarily a corn soy operation now, but years back it was we had everything from chickens and pigs and cattle and everything under the sun. And so I have lived through that change of seeing how agriculture has changed away from some of these diversified operations into more of a simplified approach in the corn and soybean space. And as was mentioned, I spent a fair amount of time working for General Mills and our agriculture research team. I oversee our oat breeding and genetics program. Oats is a crop that's near and dear to ourselves, and so we spend a lot of time and effort on making sure we have a secure and sustainable source of oats for our Cheerios and Nature Valley and our organic brands. Also support our soil health initiatives, and that's kind of years back, probably starting back in 2010, I helped support our first field-to-market initiatives, our footprint analysis projects, where we were going out and talking to farmers around, you know, footprint and looking at, you know, fuel consumption. And that then transformed probably 3 or 4 years ago into the soil health initiatives, and we started working with the Nature Conservancy and Soil Health Partnership, Soil Health Institute, and trying to really understanding, the importance of soil and the renaissance going on around rebuilding healthy soils. And then that just recently kind of transformed into another project within General Mills, what we're referring to and calling as our regenerative agriculture. And so I'm here today to talk a little bit about, you know, why we're interested in soil health and regenerative agriculture and how we're really trying to transform that into our supply chains and how we're trying to be an enabler of adopting healthy soil practices for growers to help them become, you know, more resilient on that supply chain as well. So why is General Mills committed to regenerative agriculture? So, you know, we have a lot of brands. You recognize some of those up there. Probably some you don't, are more kind of international brands. But we have, you know, wheat brands, oat brands up there, pet food business, even a meat snacks brand that relies entirely on regenerative grazing or grass-fed grazing practices. And so we want to make sure that we have the ability to supply these brands. General Mills, as a flour milling company, has been a business for 150 years, and we want to make sure that going forward that we have, you know, access to resilient supply chains, to, you know, resilient and economically profitable farmers that are out there on the landscape, you know, producing grains that can also help us, supply our needs going forward over time as well. So that's really why we're most interested in this whole, you know, improving soil health and regenerative agriculture. And, you know, this slide here, a lot of you have probably seen those before, but, you know, like I said, 10 years ago, we started down the sustainability path, and that was good, but sustainability in itself can be, you know, it's kind of a questionable activity, because are we trying to sustain a degraded resource? And in some parts of the country, in some areas where we source from, resources are continuing to decline and degrade over time as well. And so I think that was what eye-opening experience we had around, you know, the kind of the soil health movement that has been underway in a lot of parts of in pockets of the country, you know, for years, that we really want to try to improve those resources for farmers and for farm profitability as well. And so, you know, that we like I say, there's nothing really new on this slide you haven't seen before, but our business model really relies on, you know, taking, you know ingredients from the farm and moving them into our you know, manufacturing facilities and then producing products that meet the needs of the consumers. And there's a lot of pressure on that as we move forward. And so I'll just quickly go through some of the challenges. And again, you're all familiar with this. This is that truck stop along I-35 near Ames, I believe it is. But declining topsoil. Heard some great presentations from different soil scientists around the country. I mean, they're not great, but they're kind of dire in their message about how topsoil is declining in parts of the country. In Iowa and the Red River Valley, talk about how topsoil used to be talked about in terms of feet per acre, and now it's down to like less than 12 inches per acre in some places. And I think back to my own parents' farm. We have some fields that I'm not sure there's any topsoil left on those fields. So much tillage and whatnot going on over the years. So it's a challenge that we're facing. Loss of biodiversity. There's been some reports that came out this past year from Yale and Cornell. The loss of species biodiversity. We heard just minutes ago in the introductions we had today. You know, the importance of pollinators and biodiversity, both insect, plant, and bird biodiversity on the landscapes, and the value that that can provide to producers, but then also to the ecosystem services at large. And so that's a concern. John Foley, who was formerly at the University of Minnesota, talked about where the footprint, the GHG footprint, is going or has been. And if you look at where the projected line is versus really where it needs to go, as well. And so we see that the greenhouse gas continues to increase from farming practices as well. And so we really need to make a change around that as well. And then lastly, farmer economic situation has not improved necessarily over time. Growers and farmers continue to manage a lot of money and input and move a lot of money through their systems, but the amount of dollars that farmers are able to keep is less. It has remained relatively flat, constant, compared to the rising costs of inputs as well that go into producing crops. And so we've had this and another concern that we worry about as farmers. I need to stay in business. And now I'm going to just share, I got a couple, three slides here around consumer attitudes towards, the food production system and in general, as we think about that. And so consumers are, and this is recent research that we work with. We work with different entities that really focus on consumer attitudes and beliefs as we think about products that we're developing. Who has the most responsibility to bear for making the world a more sustainable and better place? And this is just relatively recently, and it's really changed in the last year or two as well. And so large companies are viewed as being part of the problem, and so they also are viewed as being the ones that can make the most change or improve the most or have the most responsibility to bear to make changes on the for environmental and sustainability outcomes. And you can see second, 84% of the public feel that it's at least in the top three choices that they give, that it's large companies. And then you see governments are second as well. And interestingly enough, individuals feel that they're the third line item there, that although they are an important part of solving some of these sustainability and environmental issues, it does reside with governments and large companies. And then consumers have changed again recently in their willingness to prioritize the greater good when it comes to purchasing of products. And again, it's just a two-year snapshot in time here, but the reason for purchasing sustainability or products, there used to be kind of the idea that consumers would make or buy would make a decision to buy a product or choose a product because they felt like it was important for themselves or for their family. And that was a big driver of how they made choices around the products that they would either consume or buy or drive or something to that effect, or packaging and such like that. And if you think of the organic industry, this information would be similar for that as well. But if you look at the 2019 data chart there, that there's been a shift in a little bit of that attitude where growers are willing to make purchasing decisions based not just for themselves or their family, but more so for the earth, the environment, and for the greater good. And that's a big change. That's something that's relatively new, because I think as a food company over the years, going back, like I said, 2010, when we were looking at like footprint analysis, there was no way you could market or no way you could talk to about how you know, farmers are doing this, and they're, you know, more sustainable, and they're producing more with less, and they're, you know, moving their footprint down, but it doesn't really necessarily resonate with farmers or consumers. It was hard to put on a package or to talk about or to even sell. I mean, we'd put it on our, like, our corporate sustainability reports are on our webpage, but probably nobody even looked at it. So that's a big change, and maybe in some ways that's good as we think about the soil health improvements, soil health renaissance that's going on. This talk about regenerative, you know, agriculture, about improving farm, you know, the farm ecosystem overall. So that could be, that's good news as well. And then just finally, this kind of similar to the first slide I showed, but, you know, important for companies and businesses to focus on making sure they're doing the right thing, you know, and addressing, you know, pollution, contamination, decreasing waste. So you think about plastics, that's packaging in the food industry is a challenge, and not the food and beverage industry, you know, switching to renewable energy sources. So consumers are continuing to look at that and have interest in those areas. And a little bit, another, and this is, you know, why General Mills is interested in, you know, kind of working with soil and with this regenerative ag space is that of our supply chain, 52% of the GHG associated with the products that we end up putting on the shelf, 52% of that does reside within agriculture and that transformation phase. And so the farming operations and transportation into the system. And so when we set this goal to reduce our GHG emissions as a company 28% by 2025. And that was a goal that was actually, that was put considerable thought into that. And then if we want to reduce it by like another 50% by the year 2050. And so initial reaction was like, well, let's just look inside our own four walls. And if you can look there, you see manufacturing and packaging. That's the orange box there. 9% of the footprint resides within our own four walls. And so if you think about if we turn the thermostat down in our own warehouses and we change all the light bulbs to LED lights and such like that, we really still wouldn't be making a big impact in general to our overall supply chain. We've done a lot of work within those manufacturing facilities. We've changed how, you know, shipping containers and such like that, and the packaging and selling, consumer use, you know, how they cook and how they dispose of or how they throw away unused food. That's all captured in that 17%. But so we really realize that there's a lot of potential in the front end of that on agriculture, and it doesn't have to really be all about, like, you know, setting rules and checklists and such for farmers. It's really just around the way that they can improve practices on the farm that hopefully are more profitable for themselves as well. So we've had a lot of sustainability commitments over time. I just kind of wanted to, you know, show that it's not really anything that, you know, new. That, like I mentioned, you know, back in 2010, we started, you know, sustainably source our top 10 priority ingredients, which included oats and wheat and sugar beets and dairy and such. We have a large pollinator program, which is still 2 years left. We're on track to put in 100,000 acres of pollinator habitat across our sourcing regions. That includes both our organic brands and our conventional brands, including right here in North Central North Dakota. We worked with NRCS to get pollinator habitat established with our oat growers in that region over the last few years, and that does include also activities in Manitoba and Saskatchewan that supply our oats. When you think of Honey Nut Cheerios, it seemed like a good place to move that. Working in at-risk watersheds, packaging and recycling by design, and then we just most recently came out with this goal to assist farmers in advancing regenerative agriculture on 1 million acres. Okay, so how does General Mills define regenerative agriculture? So I think that we can just jump right into that. So General Mills defines regenerative agriculture as practices that intentionally enhance and restore natural resources on the farm and those farming communities. And we've come about this by not creating additional checklists or not coming out and talking to our suppliers about thou shalt or not coming out and saying, you know, we got to get growers to come on and do this or do that and can't do this and can't do that. We've really focused on measuring, working with growers within our supply chain regions and measuring and providing resources to farmers for one-on-one coaching with influential partners that we've identified within our supply chain regions where we have some examples. So that one-on-one coaching for farmers, we're spending resources then against measuring outcomes over time. So like over the course of 3 years or 5 years and focusing on measuring the outcomes in soil health. And so that's very well developed over time. So you can think about what all the work that the NRCS and others have been doing. That's the easy one, is measuring soil health. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. The second area is the focusing on biodiversity, and so we're focused on, you know, all types of biodiversity. So measuring changes or improvements to, you know, what resides in the soil, what resides above ground, plant communities, insect beneficial communities, predator-pest relationship, insect communities, and bird species, nesting bird species, biodiversity in that regard as well. So we have programs in place to measure those outcomes. And then the third area is farmer economic resilience. And we really don't have that one. I mean, we've got ideas around that, but as we work with our farmers, it's really kind of up to them to decide, are they better off, you know, over the course of the 3 to 5 years that we're working with them or not? And I can get into more details about that a little bit later. But we're also thinking about it from a supply chain resilience. We want, you know, farmers are more economically resilient and more profitable within regions we buy grain from. And then the communities are more resilient in those areas as well. We believe that then our supply chain should be more stable, more successful as well, and resilient over time also. So that's how we internally are defining and understanding around regenerative agriculture. We're by no means out trying to develop, like I say, another checklist or another measurement model or something to that extent going forward. And so we talk about regenerative agriculture, and we know that it, you know, really hinges on improving soil health, but there's a lot of things that tie in together as you improve soil health over time. And I just actually had a conversation earlier today as we talked with another, you know, farmer that, you know, there's all these other things that farmers are dealing with as they're improving their soil health, you know, pests and weeds and disease and, you know, nutrient deficiency. And it's always trying to fix, you know, one of these or one or the other or trying to work on all these at the same time. But the, you know, what we're seeing and understanding and as we work with the research community is really understanding that, you know, if you can improve the soil health over time and you've adopted practice to, you know, minimize the disturbance and such, and that the healthier the ecosystem is, that some of these problems listed here should go away. They may not all go away, and they may not all go away every year, but they should be less. And we're hearing a lot of information from growers like that, and we're seeing some data as well along the way. This, you know, repairing broken ecosystems or water cycles, this was taken from a grower that we do know in Kansas. The grower had worked with the grower on the farmer advisor had worked with the farmer on the right hand side, no-till and cover crops for multiple years, and the same, you know, so this is just a road. These aren't stitched together pictures. The grower on the right, the no-till, the cover crops for several years. The grower on the left, you know, lots of tillage, and, you know, no cover crops, a short cropping system, no crop diversity there. And you can just see that, you know, the water, you know, running off the field, the water ponding on the soil versus the field on the right. And so, again, this just provides, you know, evidence to us, and maybe some of you have seen this on your own farms and your own operations and your own neighbors within the state or around the region or wherever you're from. And so this is just an example of what we're striving for. And if you think about the four pillars I just shared here, soil health, biodiversity, farmer economic resilience, water quality or water quantity could also be one of those pillars, because if you fix the soil, hopefully you have better water availability to future crops and clean water, either running off into surface water or infiltrating down into the soil. This information on this slide should not come as any surprise to anybody here. We didn't invent this stuff. This is information that comes from the NRCS and from North Dakota State University and other universities. You know, minimizing disturbance, maximizing crop diversity, keep the soil covered, you know, keep a living root in the ground as much as possible year-round, and where possible, incorporate livestock. And so this is kind of the message that we've been going out with to, again, within our areas where we have, you know, growers interested within our oat, wheat, and dairy supply chains, and we share this information with them, and growers can kind of pick and choose where it makes sense to participate in any one of those five areas or adopt all of them if they so desire. And so these are how we kind of think about the principles of regenerative agriculture or improving soil health. And so I just, you know, this is a picture that I'm familiar with and probably you have seen as well, you know, where I grew up in southern Minnesota. You know, what do you see that's missing? And it's relatively straightforward. It's one or all of these concepts or principles on this previous slide. But the other question is this field organic or conventional? And I think that's a good question as well, too, because really by looking at it, you don't necessarily know. It could be either one or both. And so that's another good question. And I just wanted to put that question out to there. The question is, but is it regenerative? And the question is probably not. You're probably not increasing soil health on that field like that. I just wanted to take a quick step back because I failed to mention it earlier. Is that field organic or conventional? At General Mills, because we have a sizable organic brand business within our company, the majority is our conventional brands, but we do have a lot of organic brands. We look at some of these soil health principles and practices in regenerative agriculture as a pathway forward for all growers, whether you're organic, whether you're conventional, whether you're transitional, or kind of borderline as well too, because there's something there in those five principles that is applicable to anyone and everybody's farming system. And so we have organic growers and conventional growers side by side working in our pilots on those five principles at the same time, because we feel like it's a way to move everybody forward. So as we go from this field, is it regenerative? And the question is, well, no, but this one potentially is, or this one here could be. This was taken by one of the individuals on my team, Steve Rosenzweig. He's our soil scientist that works for General Mills. He was out visiting a farm here in North Dakota. Just, commenting that in November, look at all the green material you have there in that field that's, photosynthesizing and pulling carbon out of the atmosphere, putting it back and sugars back into the soil, and improving that soil microbiome. I just wanted to, this here's a picture, so what do you see in this picture, and does it look regenerative in some of those principles or not? So I got my MS and my PhD in weed science at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and that was in the early 1990s, and so we would definitely strive for this. This was like what you wanted. This was 100% control of weeds. This was like the perfect scenario, right? And not to say that there's anything wrong with that. If you can get to that point, that that's still great. But I guess one of the things that we're seeing as we work with growers, is a little bit, oh, it's even got the credit down below. Look at that. As a picture that Steve must have found somewhere, somehow. A little bit of, you have some, soil residue cover there, so you know that there's been little or no tillage in this field here. You see there's a little bit of diverse cover crop that's growing there now, and that potentially after corn harvest could take off. And so these are the kinds of things, again, that we're just like talking to growers within our supply chain and enabling or assisting them to think about and to maybe some of the practices that they can adopt on their own farms. And again, we're not, making checklists. We're just trying to enable the adoption of some of those practices. Okay, so how are we doing that within our supply chains? So we have a lot of, a lot of work. We've tried a bunch of things over time, but in the last year and a half, we've kind of zeroed in on a few things. And so we've done, kind of one-off projects in different regions of North Dakota and Manitoba, looking at, trying to work with growers to do some cover crops, but, it's not sustainable if it's not part of a broader system, because you do it one year and maybe it doesn't grow because it's too dry, or it's in Manitoba, it's too late and they only get a little bit of growth, and then it's, it doesn't work. So, so that's been a challenge. We're working with a couple different, experts. We've got a long-term project going with the University of Manitoba now on cover crop adoption for oats or small grains within Manitoba and Saskatchewan. We're doing some other some projects there. We're working with Walsh County Conservation District that some of you might be familiar with, and some sugar beet work, and we'd like to expand that. We're working with Soil Health Partnership on a wheat project in northwest Minnesota, kind of bordering the Red River Valley there. We're working with this oat pilot that I'll get into, and some cover crop projects. I'm not going to read the rest of them, but you can kind of see, so we are doing some of these things. But I think we've also, just quick to point out that our, one of our organic brands has been also involved with, doing some of these practices in Montana and bringing along like a three-way crop rotation and putting it into a mac and cheese product. We've been supporting a lot of intercrop studies in Manitoba and Saskatchewan, and also at NDSU Carrington Research Site for quite a few years, both for organic and conventional growers. So just some examples of that. But really what we've decided to do is go into supply chains, like key supply chain regions, supply sheds, as maybe we refer to them now more so. And we focused on, kind of some of our big items, big spend items, and also maybe some of the, key areas that we can, track ingredients. And so, for example, the first one, oats in the Northern Plains, encompasses North Dakota, Manitoba, and Saskatchewan. We recently announced a project partnership with farmers in Kansas. There's hard red winter wheat for our flour mills in Kansas City. We have a yogurt production facility for the Yoplait brand in Michigan, and working with dairy farmers in those areas as well. And so really, the model is really kind of simple. Now, we've only been at this for a year or so, but really what it really comes down to is we provide, you know, we go and talk to our grain handler partner suppliers, or it could be in the case of dairy, the dairy co-op supplier to our facility. Go talk to them, and in different those regions I've shared with you up there is, you know, identify who are some of those trusted partner consultants that farmers feel comfortable working with, or who do they go to for advice. And so in each of these regions, it changes, you know, universities, independent consultants, conservation districts, NRCS, nonprofits, and Understanding Ag Consulting company as well. And so what it really then comes down to is we work with those supplier partner farms of ours, and we identify growers, and we have growers that are interested in participating in this, and then we finance the personalized coaching or assistance to those farmers, and that includes all these measurement activities I talked about. And the growers then implement this a farm plan for their farm, for their field, you know, looking at soil health and regenerative agriculture going forward. So that's kind of how the program was set up. And then, well, this past year, we were able to put out some, you know, signs up in, you know, North Dakota and Manitoba and Saskatchewan. And let me just get a little bit into that. So really here is just a quick map of the regions that we operated in. We had five farmers from North Central North Dakota that supply some oats to one of our partner grain elevators. And then the remainder are in Manitoba and Saskatchewan. And these represent really diversified farmers. An interesting story how we got to 45 or why 45. When we started talking about this like 18 months ago, we were kind of like, well, could we get five farmers that might be interested in doing something like this? Would they even want to even come to the first meeting? I said, we could probably get like 15 or 20 farmers that maybe would come and listen, but I don't know, maybe five would be a realistic goal if we could get five to do this. So we did, we worked with Understanding Ag and their soil health academies, and we did an academy in Brandon, Manitoba, and York and Saskatchewan, and both locations were totally sold out, totally filled up. We had before that, as we saw that the interest was overwhelming, we said, okay, well, let's do 25 growers. We have enough funding, we can do 25 growers for coaching going forward. Well, that ended up being, we ended up going to 45 growers at the end of the day because we had so much overwhelming interest. Of those 45 growers, there are nine growers in there that are organic growers, and the remainder are conventional growers that are on varying pathways, including the organic growers, varying pathways. You know, some growers have had, you know, no experience with no-till or cover crops or any of the other principles. Other growers are kind of, you know, down the pathway, you know, that are pretty experienced with a no-till and cover, you know, obviously not a whole lot of cover crops probably as you keep moving further north. But we wanted to really, as a kind of the test, or kind of our idea behind all this was, you know, we didn't want to like couch our bets here and just pick all the growers that had already adopted these principles. We really wanted to like have it a challenge, and so growers that really didn't have anything going in this area. And so that represented that. So that's been for a year now, and we've had the coaching. We're coming into the second year of our coaching, and we've been going out and doing a lot of baseline measurement of their existing soil state, the biodiversity, insect and bird biodiversity, and then also have not done anything just quite yet with the economic resilience per se in those regions. The second area that was just launched and made publicly available here a couple of, in the last month, is the same example. We had two of these soil health academies in Kansas, totally sold out, totally overwhelmed. The one in Hutchinson, Kansas had met and exceeded the threshold of the number of people within, I don't know, several weeks before it was even held. The interest was overwhelming. In this scenario, it was, you see some of the partners up there, K-State and Colorado State University are also part of some of the work that's going on as well. But it's interesting is in this region, this is a wheat region from the blue dots west that supplies, you know, the flour milling industry. This is kind of a little bit of a unique story. So there's this area there referred to as the Cheney Lake Watershed. And the Kansas Department of Health and Environment was also working in and concerned about water quality within that region because that watershed supplies the city of Wichita. water to that community. And so it was a stroke of luck where the stars aligned and we were able to partner up with that organization to go in and work specifically, and you can see it on the map, you know, kind of that region of with farmers, the wheat farmers in that area, corn, soybean, wheat farmers, winter wheat growers that were in there. And again, and what we offered to them again was the, you know, the coaching, the measurement, you know, those types of things. And I think there's 24 or 25 farmers that are getting the full one-on-one coaching. The green dots that you see there, those are growers that are not getting this. Those are growers that will be in the Soil Health Partnership, if you're familiar with that organization. So they'll be getting a lower level of consulting or from Soil Health Partnership, but they'll be asked to try, you know, some cover crops or no cover crops or no till or with no till, that, you know, those types of activities, and doing some baseline soil sampling there as well. And so this is kind of an interesting, you know, kind of project we have in place. And if you think about a pyramid, we had a lot of growers in the state of Kansas that were participating in our field to market enterprise. So 100 growers, a couple hundred growers, you know, where they were just, you know, we'd meet once a year and we'd talk about like footprint analysis. Nobody really knew exactly, you know, what that really meant at the end of the day. And they'd share some data about, you know, how much fuel they used in their tillage operations and that type of thing. So we kind of had that pyramid of that, or the base of the pyramid built. And then the second layer of that is really the Soil Health Partnership work, where they're going on out, kind of talking with growers and talking about a few practices that they can implement on their farm. And then the third, kind of the tip of the spear, is the one-on-one coaching and farm development plans with Understanding Ag to develop regenerative practices on their farm. And so really just kind of just some nice pictures here that, you know, it's really what we're really going out to do. Education, one-on-one coaching, we're trying to build communities and improve soil, wildlife, profit, measurement, and improve those over time. Just another activity that we're involved with, some of you may or may not heard about, but the Environmental Services Market Consortium. It's a group of all these companies that are looking at, you know, what is the possibility as farmers adopt these practices on their farm, the soil health improvement practices, and can document more carbon storage on their farm over time. I mean, how do we measure that? How do we demonstrate the improvements over time? And then is there a carbon market that could be launched at a national level? And so we're participating in that. So so not only is the, you know, improving soil health and, you know, some of this regenerative ag, you know, should be able to see some improvements to, you know, profitability at the farm level, but there's conversations about, you know, is carbon market trading one of those? And so General Mills is a member of that. We're looking at that as well. That might be of interest to some of the farmers here in this room. As you improve, you know, soil over time, add carbon back to the soil, would you be eligible to carbon market trading? So that's an example. And then, of course, higher nutrient density grains or foods coming off that off your farm might be of interest as well, too. And I just have a quick slide on that as well towards the end. And so measuring regeneration. And so I talked about this quite a bit, you know, so we're spending a lot of the effort up front is, you know, kind of that consulting and that one-on-one coaching with the growers and, you know, kind of enabling, you know, their progress and their success if they're interested in these various supply chains. But really what then we feel like what we want to do to be able to, you know, to share back with growers and the GHG reduction and also consumers to get, you know, kind of their interest in these areas is talk about, you know, improvements in water quality and biodiversity and, you know, supply chain resilience, you know, some of those actions as well. And so I'll just kind of quickly cover like what it is we set out to do and why we want to do it. I started the talk off by saying, you know, why is a food company like General Mills, and I think we're not alone, you know, Walmart is interested in Danone. You've probably seen, you know, some of the action that they're doing like within their dairy supply chain as well. But it's really just, you know, on the lower right-hand corner, we have drought. On the upper left-hand corner, we have floods. You see, you know, maybe yields, and this could be at the individual field level or at a, you know, a small regional level or supply chain region as we think about them. You know, variability to yields and, you know, over time. But through regenerative practices, is there a way we can come up with through some sort of measurement mechanisms, you know, using satellite imagery, looking at changes to the landscape over time? you know, can you see less of that bounce in there? And that should then result in, you know, more stable supply chains and more stable, you know, profitability for farmers and for everybody involved in the system, the grain handlers and everybody as well. And this top right-hand box, that's just a recent study. You can see the date there, September 2019. Basically, it's hard to read this chart, but there's an organization we work with, Dagen, used to be Applied Geo Solutions. And really, what the bottom line is saying is they worked in three counties, one in Ohio, one in South Dakota, and one in Missouri, and looked at growers that had adopted no-till and cover crops, their ability, were they successful at getting those crops planted this last spring in the extreme wet weather that was happening in these counties that had a high percentage of prevent plant. And so you see the comment there about prevent plant, and then the other circle to the above successful. Were they actually able to plant that? And so we're kind of looking at this. This is just, like I said, came out just this last fall, but they went to the three counties that had high levels of prevent plant due to excessive rainfall. And where they surveyed through satellite imagery growers that had been adopting no-till and cover crops versus growers that versus farmland fields. They didn't know who the growers were. Farmland fields that had not had a history through satellite imagery of no-till and cover crops. And farmland fields that had higher levels of no-till and cover crops overall were more likely to be successfully planted this past growing season in those three counties there, Missouri, South Dakota, and in Ohio. So it gives us reason to believe that there is something there. As you improve some of those soil practices, soil health over time, it should enable successful planting in a spring that we had like this past year with lots of rain and lots of flooding. The soil health piece, we've talked about that a little bit, but this is the area where we're most developed. And understanding is how to measure soil health, and so not necessarily anything new here, but, you know, looking at, you know, we're measuring as baseline for all of our farmer participants, you know, soil carbon, the aggregate stability, active carbon, water infiltration rates. That always seems to be one of interest with farmers. Penetration resistance, we're doing soil samples for the PLFA test, that's that microbial community within the soil. Haney test, and then some other projects as well. So we're going on out, we're doing all this testing with farmers and providing that information back to them and providing that baseline. We're doing insect, bird, and bird surveys, intensive bird and insect surveys across this past year in the Northern Plains, so in Manitoba and Saskatchewan and in North Dakota, where we've been on out multiple times throughout the year collecting insect samples, looking at, again, both pro and con, you know, pest and beneficial and pollinator and that type of thing, and then also looking at nesting birds. A lot of the north central North Dakota and Manitoba, Saskatchewan is the prairie pothole region, and so we've gone on out and looked at the nesting birds within those areas as well, and looking at a baseline of birds and duck species, waterfowl species, those types of things. With the thought is that over time, as growers maybe adopt some of these better practices and you improve water quality on the farm site, would you see an improvement or an increase in some of these bird species as well over time? And we're working with a couple of key partners on that as well. I'm trying to, again, some of these things are kind of build the plane as you're flying it, and so we're introducing a couple other partners within the bird biodiversity piece as well as we move forward as well. I talked a little bit about this organization, Dagen, you know, using, you know, satellite imagery to help predict, you know, changes on the landscape, such as no-till and cover crops and crop rotation schemes. My impression is I've been digging into this, satellite imagery has been able to determine what the crop was previous year, going back to the crop data layers website that has been out there for quite some time. But this technology also can model, you know, like greenhouse gas emissions, looking at denitrification and the nitrous oxide life cycle within soils as well. And really, can we understand through satellite imagery changes in practices, you know, no-till and cover crops and GHG associated with those farmers are working with an organization to do that. And then looking at these biodiversity indices on farm and see if we don't see improvements in biodiversity as well. And then lastly, I'm going to say just something that's kind of that we know the least about, but we had a great conversation earlier this morning, and that's in the, that's in this area here. I talked about, you know, soil health measurements, biodiversity and such, but really it's around nutrient density. And I know that I spend a little bit of time on Twitter following a lot of farmers that are kind of moving down the soil health and regenerative pathway. Talk to a lot of farmers, talk to a lot of beef, you know, cow-calf operation farmers, even dairy farmers that talk about as they've made changes on their farm to improve soil health, if they've adopted things like rotational grazing, as they've improved the organic matter on their soil, as they've put more carbon back into the soil, as they've changed up their rotation schemes, that they're seeing some nutrient changes on in the products that they're selling. In their grains, some changes in nutrient density within their grains or within the beef that they sell or within the dairy products that they sell. And I think that's an area that we know the least about as an organization ourselves, and so I'm not going to say that we're by no means experts in that space. But I think it's an area that we need to to understand. I think maybe, you know, I think from a farmer perspective, there's a lot of interest in that. If you're going through some of these activities, it's another pathway to success for farmers, for growers. And I also think that it might be a way that consumers can get behind this as well, too, and kind of pull some of these activities through the supply chain. So we're doing some very rudimentary tests right now within our own supply chains, our oat and wheat programs as we move forward, and working with and identifying a handful of farmers that have some longtime practitioners of soil health improvements versus some very conventional practices. And, you know, looking at, so for example, in our oat supply chain, you know, kind of looking at variety and geography and management and the measurement of soil health, and then what do we see in those grains that come off those fields? And then there's a couple other, you know, organizations that are starting to get into that as well too. And then, you know, I just in conversations this morning, you know, kind of what role could like ARS play in that as well? Could be something for future research also. So that's a question that comes up a lot, and we see it a lot, but don't have a good answer for that just yet, because I think that there definitely needs to be some good, hard data collected and look at the science behind that. So with that, here's a field day in Melfort, Saskatchewan. But anyway, questions? I see one right here. Yeah.
As you said on the questions on nutrient density, that's essentially, are you separating some of your findings between varieties of, say, like oats, and so that producers can say, well, this one is better for humans or cows, and I assume their digestion is not the same. There's just a lot of questions on this. Are you publishing some of these things so that we know where we're going with this? Otherwise, you go to the elevator and it's weight and protein and away you go.
Yeah. So there's a couple of really good questions there. Are we publishing the information? Yeah. So all the information that we're going, that we're generating, like on biodiversity and we're part of, the nutrient density piece. At this point, we're not necessarily owning that. We're just trying to look to see if it could be done. And so we view a lot of these activities as kind of in that pre-competitive space. And so the biodiversity piece that'll be published eventually with those partners. So the big question of that is around supply. So working with these growers in these regions, and then are we separating or tracking that back into our processing facilities and into the products? And the answer to that is right now, no, we're not. And there's a couple of reasons there, because we're still a commodity grain-based system out there, and a lot of the oats and wheat, we buy our commodities in that regard. And the second thing is that, I pointed out, we got 45 growers in the Northern Plains and 25 in Kansas. I mean, and, three dairy farmers, that scale at that point doesn't necessarily, do much for that. I think that, and I think that's kind of why I ended with this, kind of some of these unknowns within that nutrient density place. And over time, I think there could be more ability to do that. If you recall, I just briefly showed one of our organic brands that did do some work with organic growers in Montana, and it was oats and peas, and they tracked it all the way through the system, and into the product, So, I mean, those things can happen. They're costly and time-consuming, but at this point, we are not segregating any of our supply chain as of yet. We're really just trying to build some critical mass over time That could take a couple, three, four more years.
When you talk to your marketing people, assuming you do, I mean, when do you know when you can start promoting products as based on regenerative ag and not organic? And, and consumers can go, wow, I want to buy and support that. So how do you...
That's a really good question. And you're right. Our marketing teams have spent considerable amount of time talking about that. Tip of the spear, organic consumers kind of get the concept of building soil health. Mainstream conventional consumers, it's definitely more of a challenge talking about regenerative ag, because I don't think that regen ag maybe is the right word. Maybe it's talking, and it could be like through, improving biodiversity or improving, clean water, improving soil health, improves, clean water, some of those types of things. And is that, do you talk about that like on a package? Do you make a claim? Do you talk about it on your website or in your, we do this sustainability report annually, those types of things. I think it's really a good question. And I tried to hit on it a little bit at the on those three slides I had on consumer attitudes where maybe it's, we're not selling, does it get to a point where you almost have to do these things to, to improve the environment, but again, consumers are not necessarily buying it on that. I think of, we used to think back in the day 10 years ago, the sustainability footprint stuff was just table stakes, just to get your stuff on the shelves of Walmart. And I don't know if it'll ever come that way with Regen Ag or that, but maybe not. But I think it's something that we just need to keep looking at, talking to consumers about. Because I don't think they get Regen Ag, but they might get like water quality and biodiversity and saving butterflies and something like that.
One more question. I noticed in your presentation you had 170,000 acres and 45 producers that were oats growers. In looking at your marketing, only five were from the United States. The remainder were from northern Manitoba and Saskatchewan. Is that because we don't produce enough oats in the United States, or that there isn't a market for it? Because most of our marketing now, especially in some of the higher areas in Minnesota, is a corn soybean market, and that's based on profitability and where you can make the bottom line.
I think you answered your own question. It comes down to what farmers can grow profitably, and I think that it wasn't that long ago, in the 1990s, we were getting oats out of Iowa and the Dakotas and parts of Minnesota, and just changes in economics and the ability to grow corn and soybeans further north all the time successfully was really what kind of pushed a lot of that oats further north. And so it's driven by those types of economics. I think there's a little bit too around just as those changes have happened with corn and soybean, the whole infrastructure. We partner with there's a group in Iowa called Practical Farmers of Iowa. Some of you may have heard of, and they're really struggling. They really want to get like oats and hard red spring or winter wheat back into the rotation in Iowa, a state that really kind of needs it. It's primarily a corn soy rotation, but What's really kind of happened is there's no public oat breeder left in Iowa, so there's no varieties that have good disease resistance or good, heat tolerance. You don't have any infrastructure left, grain handlers. Farmers don't have the combine headers to cut the oats or wheat that they're interested in, and so it's really been a struggle. We continue to do variety trials that we help facilitate, sponsor, test those types of things, but it's really just getting growers interested in critical mass, and then it always comes down to the price, right? And growers, the corn soy has just been so fine tuned in those regions for so long that oats just aren't competitive, and it just continues to be pushed further north.
Thanks, Tom. And just for the audience, we will be talking more about nutrient density yet this morning, and also, we are doing more work on oat research in the U.S. now as well. The industry has actually helped to get some new money to some ARS labs to do oat research, so we're hoping to try and change that and that paradigm. You mentioned a lot, thanks for your presentation, you mentioned a lot about consulting and coaching the farmers into these directions. I'm just curious to what extent this program is capturing information back from them as to the feasibility of these ideas that you're presenting to them and how you're going to manage all that information and use that to move forward?
Yeah, that's a great question. Capturing information back from the farmer participants to get their feedback. And so we're working. We've got an app that we've given to all the growers in the Northern Plains, and they can upload information about their practices and, you know, kind of what they're seeing. We started a private, I think it's a Facebook page, you know, for growers to exchange information on what they're doing and kind of how things are going. But you're right. We really want, the two things there is we really want to enable success, and we want growers to feel like they're successful. And so capturing that data and understanding that with them so that we can expand this out and then developing these social networks within these regions that we're developing as well, too, because we can't think that we're going to, you know, continue this model for forever, right? It's not going to work that way. But we can do it for, you know, 3 to 5 years or beyond, depending on the needs. But, you know, really what we're hoping to see is creating like hotspots within production areas, you know, where growers have, you know, they've been successful, they're understanding the success, we're sharing that information back with the growers and with a broader community of interested growers. There's other, you know, expertise consultants, you know, that are available to help further that success as well. And so it's really, yeah, we're really trying to, you know, understand what works and what doesn't work, but then kind of get that to like move on out on its own so it grows organically across supply regions as well. And I'm glad you brought up the information about the oat research. Yes, I shared that with a few people last night, so.
All right, let's give Tom a hand. Thank you.